worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
One of the lectionary readings from last Sunday. Last Sunday was Father's Day, and I did not preach on last Sunday, but as I've shared with you, wanting to continue or complete this preaching series on one God, one people. So today I want to read Genesis, the 21st chapter, verses 8a through verse 20. Listen now to the reading of the word. Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very depressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Wherever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning, took bread and a skim of water, and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. As she departed and wandered about the wilderness of Beersheba, when the water in the skim was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him, a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skim with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we are so grateful for another opportunity to stand before your people. As we come this moment of the day, O Lord, I ask for your anointing. Open our eyes, O God, that we may see, our ears to hear, our hearts to believe, our heads to understand, and our wills to obey. Oh God, be with us in this hour. I pray now that you will give me grace to proclaim your word with passion and with power. Speak, Lord, for we are listening. And the people of God say,
amen.
Amen. It appears COVID-19 has brought out the best and the worst in human nature. The tendency to ask, but why, often accompanies the need for rules and regulation. The health officials have repeatedly said that face covering is an adequate method to avert the spreading of the virus, with staying at home being the best option. Yet people are asking, but why? I feel fine. People do not understand that they can be asymptomatic and unaware of the contagion in their bodies, which can affect others. COVID-19 is a global pandemic rather than decreasing the number of infections. Therefore, we must embrace the slogan that what affects one directly affects all indirectly. The reaction to societal issues is often the same approach when it comes to spiritual matters. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
Many of our problems arise from ignoring God's word when we don't think God's instructions make sense, or it goes against what we want to do. God promises Abraham that he would be the father of many nations. Yet his barren wife Sarah was well past the childbearing age, thought that she needed to help God. While they were waiting for the fulfillment, some 25 plus years, Sarah decides that she needed to help God, with Abraham being a willing partner. She gives her maid Hagar to him, and Hagar gives birth to Ishmael. How many times have we messed up our lives trying to help God out? How many times? We rationalize that God, the God of the universe, must not care or know what I'm experiencing. We tell ourselves that God must have forgotten, and therefore I need to step in the matter. If God says it, God will do what he says. God is not like human that he should lie. You see, we make promises that we don't keep. God keeps all of God's promises. So rather than wait on God, we move ahead and we create problems for ourselves. Then we pray, oh God, why did you not stop me? Haven't we done it? Haven't we thought it? What we really want, we want to control God, and we are demanding to know the game plan and the timeline. But God doesn't operate on our demands. God responds to our faith. It takes faith to wait on God. So here it is, 25 years later from that first promise, the fruition, and Isaac is born to a barren 90-year-old woman. Glory to God. What is impossible to us is possible to God. What we are seeing happening in our world today, there were people who predicted that some of the changes would never happen. But they're happening. What is impossible to us? What seems impossible to us is always possible with God. So in our text today, the family is celebrating the rites of passage of Isaac's wee everyone is enjoying the festivity. Ishmael and Isaac are playing. Perhaps Ishmael, being an older brother, is teasing his younger brother. And that's just what children do. But Sarah sees and perceives Hagar and her son as a threat to her livelihood. She demands that Ishmael and Hagar be disinherited and thrown out of the family. Cast this woman, not just this woman, but this slave woman with her son. For this slave woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son Isaac. This is not her first time asking Abraham to send her away. This is, in fact, her second time. Don't the story sounds familiar? The fruit from Sarah's decision to help God returns a harvest that she did not like. We must be careful of our decisions because we cannot turn back the hands of time. We cry out in desperation for time to wait, but time is silent and rushes on. Therefore, we must be careful of the decisions that we make. Whether it's now or later, there will always be consequences for our disobedience. Sarah's bitterness toward Hagar and Ishmael distresses Abraham. And rightly so, he loves his son and he cares for his mother. But even though Abraham was a willing party in the decision to help God out, Abraham is a faithful man. And the promise that God made, God will keep that promise. And so God tells Abraham to honor Sarah's wishes. This says for us that God is concerned about the family. God seeks unity in the family. So even when we mess things up, Lord have mercy, God continues to be faithful. God assures Abraham that Ishmael will not be disinherited. People of God, there's enough resources for all of us. We serve a God of abundance, not a God of scarcity. We need not hold back from helping one another because God will replenish all of our needs. Abraham gives Ishmael and Hagar over to the Lord. He loves them. He has no choice. He gives them over to the Lord and trusts that God will take care of them. Because we never know. We never know how God will use our mistakes to bless us and to bless others. Even though Abraham does not know what the outcome, he trusts God. And that's what we are called to do. Trust God even when we cannot see the outcome. Abraham is a provider and a protector for his family. And he gives them the basic needs of water and food and sends them away. The text says to us that Hagar wanders in the wilderness. We will all have our wilderness experiences. We may not be out in the world, but we'll be pacing the floor, wondering when God is going to answer, wondering when God is going to show up. Like Hagar, she did not know what the future holds. She did not know what she needed to do, but she kept on putting one foot in front of the other. When she could not do that any longer, she surrenders her son, the impending death. The pain of watching your child or someone else's child suffers is heart-wrenching. As we see Hagar, we can empathize with the mothers we see today crying for their sons, crying for their children. God sees. God hears. An angel interrupts Hagar's helpless crying and tells her that God hears Ishmael's voice and instructs her not to be afraid. That's a good word for us today. When we see what's happening in our world, we are often afraid. But God says to us repeatedly, consistently, do not be afraid. God sees and God hears, and God will intervene. And he did in this situation. He assures Hagar that Ishmael will not be disinherited. He has an inheritance. And so Hagar's story is our story. For it is an important reminder that the God of Abraham, the God of Sarah, the God of Isaac is also the God of Hagar and Ishmael. A person's worth to God is not determined by their status, their race, their birth order, or their usefulness. To God, all life matters. Then the text said God opens her eyes to see the well that perhaps was already there. Could that be the case with us? God is already making provisions for us. But we are so inundated with our own problems. We're so focused on what's going on. We're in such a state of despair that we cannot even see the hands of God already working things out. God graciously provides an abundance of water and the promise to live. Promise of prosperity. The promise that Ishmael will be a great nation as well. And as a result, Hagar will be taken care of. God is sovereign. God is sovereign. Lord have mercy. Even when we don't believe, God is still sovereign. Praise his name. And so like Hagar and Ishmael, we were once excluded. Once abandoned, once doomed to death, then God intervened through Jesus Christ the Lord. We have been adopted by the grace and made joint heirs with the people of God. Through Christ, we are true children of Abraham, not by flesh, but by the Spirit of God. And so we come today, we come back in Rehoboth, we come to the house of God to fill our hearts with the living water of Jesus Christ. We don't come here just to sit and look, we come to fill our hearts with the loving, living, fresh water of Jesus Christ. And then we go back into the world. We go back into the world to quench the thirst of the least, the last, and the lost, who are literally and spiritually dying from thirst. And we have the living water, and we sometimes refuse to share it. They're Hagars and Ishmaels in our midst. People crying for justice. People crying for hope. Glory to God. We have been filled with the living water so that we can remind everyone that God hears them, God sees them, and God will intervene. And so I say to us, my sisters and my brothers, whether you're here in the sanctuary or you're listening to us virtually, I pray that knowing and acknowledging and accepting that God will always see, God will always hear, and God will always intervene, will give us hope to share our living water with others from this day forward. In the name of the Father, the name of the Son, name of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people say,
Amen.